Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The Day We Found the Universe, written by Marcia Bartusiak, read by Erik, Preface, January 1st, 1925. The 20s were not just roaring, they were blazing. Moviegoers were flocking to the cinema to watch in amazement as Moses parted the Red Sea in Cecil B. DeMille's silent film epic, The Ten Commandments. Greece overthrew its monarchy and proclaimed itself a republic. The first dinosaur eggs were discovered in Mongolia's Gobi Desert, and crossword puzzles became all the rage. It was the height of the Jazz Age, when Victorian ideals came tumbling down in a frenzy of flappers, Freudian analysis, and abstract art. While majestic ocean liners crossed the Atlantic in under 5 days, Clarence Birdseye introduced the public to the novelty of frozen food, and a failed artist named Adolf Hitler published Mein Kampf. It was a world, wrote F. Scott Fitzgerald in his classic novel The Great Gatsby, redolent of orchids and pleasant, cheerful snobbery, and orchestras which set the rhythm of the year, summing up the sadness and suggestiveness of life in new tunes. It was also an era of immense scientific fervor. On December 30, 1924, some 4,000 scientists descended upon Washington, D.C., to attend the annual conference of the American Association for the Advancement of Science. Taking advantage of the three-day gathering, the American Astronomical Society held its meeting in the Capitol at the same time, with nearly 80 astronomers attending from across the United States. They lodged at the Powhatan, a plush 8-story hotel located on the corner of 18th Street and Pennsylvania Avenue, where a room with private bath cost $2.50 a night, and weary travelers could relax in its rooftop garden. 2 blocks away, Calvin Coolidge opened the doors of the White House to the visiting AAAS members. While notorious for being a man of few words, the 30th President of the United States was uncharacteristically chatty the day of the reception. "It has taken endless ages to create in men the courage that will accept the truth simply because it is the truth," Coolidge told his guests. "We have advanced so far that we do not fear the results of that process. We ask no recantations from honesty and candor. Those of us who represent social organization and political institutions look upon you with a feeling that includes much of awe and something of fear, as we ask ourselves to what revolution you will next require us to adapt our scheme of human relations." 6 months later, high school biology teacher John Scopes would go on trial in Tennessee for illegally teaching Charles Darwin's theory of evolution. The astronomers, though, were scarcely aware that Washington was host to the largest number of scientists ever assembled for an AAAS meeting. Their interest was intently focused on the astronomy program, which included talks on the atmosphere of Mars, how fast celestial objects could move, the temperature of Mercury, and the latest computed orbit of the eclipsing double star system Algol. On Wednesday, the second day of the meeting, the astronomers were taken by glass-topped buses to the U.S. Naval Observatory, in the northwest sector of the town, for a tour of the facility and a buffet luncheon in its stately main hall. Later that evening, New Year's Eve, occurred an event which was marked on the program and celebrated by a number of the faithful, Popular Astronomy recounted. As the clock struck 12, astronomers happily changed to civil reckoning for determining the start of a day. No longer would the astronomical day begin at high noon, a tradition launched in the days of Ptolemy that often led to great bookkeeping confusion. Instead, it now began at midnight, just as it did for everyone else. It will probably be remembered and noted long after other astronomical happenings of the current year are forgotten, stated the magazine. But a presentation made on Thursday, New Year's Day, ultimately overshadowed all other events at the meeting. Looking out their hotel windows that inaugural morning of 1925, convention-goers discovered a blanket of snow covering the city, enough to give holiday sleds a good tryout, reported the Washington Post. Despite the ongoing snowstorm, however, the astronomers kept to their schedule and walked the short distance to the newly constructed Corcoran Hall on the nearby campus of George Washington University for a joint session with the mathematicians and physicists of the AAAS. They first heard a talk on stellar evolution, followed by a lecture posing the question, "Is the universe infinite?" which led to a lively discussion among the conferees. Then, right before the noon break, a paper modestly titled Cepheids in Spiral Nebulae was presented to the assembled audience. Those not familiar with astronomy likely imagined it was a minor technical work, of interest only to a specialist. But the astronomers in the room immediately grasped its significance. For them, it was electrifying news. Despite its lackluster title, this paper was no less than the culmination of a centuries-long quest to understand the true nature and extent of the cosmos. January 1, 1925, was the day that astronomers were officially informed of the universe's discovery. The author of the paper was 35-year-old Edwin Hubble, a staff astronomer at the Mount Wilson Observatory in Southern California. Hubble had aimed Mount Wilson's 100-inch reflector, the largest telescope in its day, toward a pair of celestial clouds known as Andromeda and Triangulum, the only spiral nebulae in the nighttime sky that can be seen with the naked eye. By having access to significant telescopic power, Hubble was at last able to resolve individual stars in the outer regions of the two mist-like clouds. And to his surprise and delight, some turned out to be Cepheids, special stars that methodically dim and brighten as if they were slow-blinking cosmic stoplights. The signals revealed that our galaxy, the Milky Way, was not alone. The Cepheids were telling Hubble that the Andromeda and Triangulum nebulae were very distant, situated far beyond our galactic borders. Our celestial home was suddenly humbled, becoming just one of a multitude of galaxies residing in the vast gulfs of space. In one fell swoop, the visible universe was enlarged by an inconceivable factor, eventually trillions of times over. In more familiar terms, it's as if we had been confined to one square yard of Earth's surface, only to suddenly realize that there were now vast oceans and continents, cities and villages, mountains and deserts, previously unexplored and unanticipated beyond that single plug of sod. Hubble directed our eyes to billions of other galaxies, other Milky Ways formerly unknown, scattered like separate atoms through space and time, as far outward as telescopes could peer. Indications of the Milky Way's true place in the universe had been cropping up for years, but the evidence was indirect, conflicting, and controversial. Hubble stepped into the fray and finally provided the decisive proof. He confirmed an idea to everyone's satisfaction that beforehand had been on far shakier ground. It was the astronomical news of the century, and yet Hubble, astonishingly, was not present at this, his moment of triumph. Instead, the staid and respected Princeton University astronomer Henry Norris Russell stood in for Hubble that morning and relayed his findings to the conferees. From all accounts, Hubble was neither sick nor detained by family matters. He might have been put off by the long and wearying cross-country train ride, but the reason for his absence was possibly more idiosyncratic. Hubble, a former legal scholar trained in weighing evidence, was concerned that by the time of the astronomy meeting, he hadn't countered every feasible argument against his finding. At his own observatory, in fact, a colleague had gathered the strongest ammunition against his conclusion, evidence Hubble couldn't yet refute. This loose end bothered him immensely. What Hubble craved was an airtight case, no stone unturned, no question left unanswered, before stepping up to the podium himself. Being caught in a scientific error was Hubble's greatest nightmare. Back in California, the young astronomer was fretfully asking himself, could I possibly be wrong? With the stunning pictures of our resplendent cosmos now so widely circulated, such a part of the routine imagery that surrounds us daily, It's difficult to remember that less than 100 years ago, astronomers' conception of the universe was very different than it is today. There were no quasars, no distant galaxies, no exotic black holes or wildly spinning neutron stars. No one even knew for sure how the sun could keep generating its tremendous energies over billions of years. What was called the universe consisted of a single disc-shaped collection of stars that cuts a magnificent swath across the celestial sky. With Earth located within this great stellar assembly, we peer outward through the disc and perceive it as a band, much the way a plate looks viewed from its side. Known since ancient times as the Milky Way, because of its ghostly white visage, our galaxy a century ago was not just the sole inhabitant of the cosmos, it was the cosmos, a lone, star-filled oasis, surrounded by a darkness of unknown depth. A few voices of dissent could be heard, arguing against this perspective. A growing number of small, spiraling clouds were being sighted in the heavens. These faint, celestial objects were lurking wherever a telescope gazed away from the Milky Way into deep space. Were these spiral nebulae close to us, or were they farther off? No one knew, because at the turn of the 20th century, astronomers didn't yet have the means to determine their distance with assured accuracy. The only thing they could do was speculate. Some looked at these nebulae, shaped like springs unwinding, and thought, ah, nearby solar systems in the making. Others observed the same tiny clouds and imagined them as a host of sister Milky Ways so distant that their stars melded into faint and misty whiteness. That would mean the Milky Way was not special at all, but merely one island of stars caught in the midst of a far larger archipelago. But the majority of astronomers rejected this strange, even frightening, concept. That other galaxies existed seemed inconceivable, and so they fiercely clung to what they perceived to be their pivotal place in the cosmos. Nicolaus Copernicus may have moved Earth and its inhabitants from the hub of the solar system in the 16th century, but humanity remained comforted by the notion that it retained a privileged position in the very heart of the Milky Way, the sole galaxy. They rested easy knowing they resided in the very center of the universe. There was no hard and fast evidence to suggest otherwise. That contentment was shattered, though, as astronomy underwent a spectacular transformation, starting in the waning years of the 19th century. This was an era of extraordinary change in every phase of human life on this planet, recalled Edwin Frost, an astronomer who had personally witnessed the transition at the Yerkes Observatory in Wisconsin. It was truly a Victorian age drawn to a close with the end of the century. When Frost was growing up in the 1880s, Europe was the touchstone in matters of literature, painting, and science. Even steel rails for the trunk lines were imported from Britain as late as my college days, he said. Then Andrew Carnegie and others found that rails could be made better and cheaper in America. The child was rapidly getting out of its infancy. Discoveries and inventions were on the rise. Seemingly overnight, there were electric lights, heating by coal, hot air furnaces, indoor bathrooms, and automobiles, smoothly traveling down asphalt-paved roads. Astronomy blossomed within this atmosphere of teeming innovation. Cameras became standard equipment on telescopes, enabling observers to gather light over an entire night, and so generate images of faint stars and nebulae never before seen. And spectroscopes, devices that separate starlight into its component colors, allowed astronomers to figure out what the stars and other celestial objects were truly made of. Suddenly, the very chemistry of the heavens was in their grasp. Meanwhile, prominent industrialists, enriched by the bounty of the Gilded Age, provided the money that allowed big dreamers to construct the large telescopes they had so long desired. Given the swift emergence of these technological improvements, dry textbook accounts, reduced to a discovery's most essential elements, make it appear as if Hubble's historic achievement had taken place overnight. He goes to the world's largest and best-equipped telescope, and voila, he reveals a cosmos populated with myriad galaxies spread over space as far as the telescopic eye could see. The Milky Way suddenly becomes a minor player in a much larger drama, and Hubble is anointed cosmology's prime architect for making this astounding breakthrough. But that is not the case at all. In reality, Hubble stood on the shoulders of a series of astronomers, far-sighted enough to tackle a problem others had been ignoring. Answers did not arrive in one eureka moment, but only after years of contentious debates over conjectures and measurements that were fiercely disputed. The avenue of science is more often filled with twists, turns, and detours than unobstructed straightaways. Astronomers trained in the older classical ways, who dwelled on calculating the motions of the planets and measuring the positions of stars to the third decimal place, had not been distressed at all by the mystery of the spiral nebulae. They figured that once the matter was resolved, it would not greatly change their perception of the overall structure and contents of the heavens. Simon Newcomb, the dean of American astronomy in the late 19th century, remarked at an observatory dedication in 1887 that, "So far as astronomy is concerned, we do appear to be fast approaching the limits of our knowledge. The result is that the work which really occupies the attention of the astronomer is less the discovery of new things than the elaboration of those already known, and the entire systematization of our knowledge." Within 10 years, James Keeler, director of the Lick Observatory in California, proved Newcomb was exceedingly short-sighted. Against everyone's advice, Keeler got a troublesome reflecting telescope, the first of its kind at high elevation, back in working order, and demonstrated its power with singular panache. Even though the telescope's mirror was relatively small, it allowed him to estimate that there were tens of thousands of faint nebulae arrayed over the celestial sky, 10 times more than had been known before. In the 1910s, Lick astronomer Heber Curtis followed up on Keeler's findings and gathered additional evidence to suggest that these many spiraling nebulae were nothing less than separate galaxies. At the same time, a few 100 miles south at Mount Wilson, near Los Angeles, Harlow Shapley resized the Milky Way, measuring it as far larger than previously thought, and shoving our sun off to the side, away from the galaxy's hub. As Shapley liked to put it, the solar system is off-center, and consequently man is too. The story of our universe's discovery centers mightily on Shapley and Hubble, scientific knights who jousted with each other for years over the universe's true structure. These arch-rivals shared similar backgrounds, and yet couldn't have been more different in temperament and tactics. Both were born in rural Missouri, and both came to astronomy through unusual routes. Hubble as a discontented high school teacher, Shapley as a crime reporter. And each, after obtaining his doctoral degree, was selected by the visionary George Ellery Hale to work at the Mount Wilson Observatory, the greatest astronomical venue in its day. Each pursued a question that few others were asking. For Shapley, it was our precise location within the Milky Way. For Hubble, our place in the universe at large. Their work took place during a crucial moment of transition. While European astronomers were diverted by World War I and its resulting turmoil, American astronomers were free to push forward on the question of the spiral nebulae. Figuring out the universe's exact configuration became an American obsession, its participants drawn from the Lick, Mount Wilson, and Lowell observatories, newly built in the western United States. The world's older observatories had no chance at all, for at the Lick and Mount Wilson observatories in particular, astronomers had access to advanced telescopes situated on prime high-elevation sites, a combination essential to cracking the mystery. Hubble gets deserved credit for providing the last, painstaking turn of the lock. Hubble's drive, scientific ability, and communication skills enabled him to seize the problem of the whole universe, make it peculiarly his own, contribute more to it than anyone before or since, and become the recognized world expert of the field, wrote astronomer Donald Osterbrock, archivist Ronald Brashear, and physicist Joel Gwynn for a centennial celebration of Hubble's birth. By 1929, just 5 years after his initial finding on the galaxies, Hubble made an even more astounding discovery. He and his colleague Milton Humason gathered the key evidence that opened the door to proving that the universe was expanding, with the galaxies continually riding the wave outward. Space-time was in motion. Half the work to reach this startling conclusion was actually performed on an Arizona mountaintop a decade earlier by Vesto Slipher, a Lowell Observatory astronomer whose vital role in arriving at this finding is now largely forgotten outside the walls of academia. Such is the power of Hubble's legend. It pushed the contributions of others into the shadows as the years progressed. This book intends to shine the spotlight once again on the entire cast of characters who contributed to revealing the true nature of the universe and laid the groundwork for Hubble's success. Knowledge of the cosmic expansion was a transforming event. It allowed astronomers to escape the confines of their home galaxy, letting them explore a far larger cosmological vista. The Milky Way was now fleeing outward, giving theorists free rein to contemplate the universe's very origin. They mentally put the cosmic expansion into reverse and imagined the galaxies drawing closer and closer to one another until they ultimately combined and formed a compact fireball of dazzling brilliance. In this way, they realized that the universe had emerged in the distant past from an enormous eruption, the Big Bang. No longer was our cosmic birth a matter of metaphysical speculation or a biased whim. It had become a scientific principle that could be tested and probed. This new cosmic outlook came about through a unique convergence, the perfect storm, of sweeping developments. Not only did a burgeoning economy provide the money and new technologies the instruments to make these discoveries, but newly introduced ideas in theoretical physics supplied some answers. No less a scientific figure than Albert Einstein had arrived on the scene with a novel theory of gravity that provided a unique explanation for the universe's bewildering behavior. A dynamism entered into the universe's workings. Einstein's equations introduced the idea that space and time are woven into a distinct object whose shape and movement are determined by the matter within it. His general theory of relativity anticipated the universe's expansion and turned its study into an intellectual and theoretical adventure. Early globetrotters had crossed the oceans in search of terra firma, solid land, new continents, previously unknown to them, and ready for exploration. With his relativistic vision of space-time as a pliable fabric that can bend and stretch, Einstein allowed astronomers to recast the ancient search into a quest for cosmos firma. Glued together by the genius physicist, space and time became cosmic real estate to be appraised, mapped, and scrutinized, with Hubble serving as its first surveyor. Hubble eventually summarized his cosmological findings in a work titled Realm of the Nebulae, which is part history, part college textbook, and part professional memoir. This book was labeled a classic by his peers at the very time it was published in 1936. And Hubble's initial take still holds up in its broad outline. His picture differs from today's only in details, Caltech astronomer James Gunn noted decades after its publication. One looks through the pages almost in vain for things that are known to be wrong. One finds a few, but we still determine the distances of the nearest galaxies by methods described by Hubble. We still mostly use Hubble's classification scheme. We still pay a great deal of attention to the questions Hubble asks. However, there is one glaring exception to Gunn's statement. Although Hubble's name is now strongly attached to the discovery of the expanding universe, he was never a vocal champion of that interpretation of his data. That was because there were other hypotheses in play in the 1930s and 1940s. Hubble was reluctant to choose sides, at a time when his newly mined data and Einstein's theory were so fresh. Hubble always coveted an unblemished record, the perfect wife, the perfect scientific findings, the perfect friends, the perfect life. His observations that the galaxies were fleeing outward were to him always apparent velocities. He wanted to protect his legacy in case a new law of physics sneaked in and changed the explanation. So far, it hasn't. Hubble was lucky in a way. The Hubble Space Telescope could easily have been given another name, had certain events turned out differently. If someone had not prematurely died, Keeler. If someone else had not taken a promotion, Curtis. Or if another, Shapley, was not mulishly wedded to a flawed vision of the cosmos. The discovery of the modern universe is a story filled with trials, errors, serendipitous breaks, battles of wills, missed opportunities, Herculean measurements, and brilliant insights. In other words, it is science writ large. Setting out. 1. The Little Republic of Science. An immense continent of rock, known as the North American Plate, slid inexorably over an oceanic slab of Earth's crust moving eastward. At the tectonic juncture, where the two gargantuan plates smashed together, the ocean floor plunged downward, the tremendous compression forging massive blocks of shale and sandstone. In due course, some of this material lifted upward from its depths, relentlessly rising toward the sky to form the Diablo Mountain Range, 200 miles of peaks and vales, stretching from the San Francisco Bay southward along California's coastline. As if readying for a performance, nature sculpted the landscape that, millions of years later, offered astronomers a unique observing platform for their studies of the cosmos. Situated on the eastern edge of the Pacific, this lofty terrain became the perfect vantage point from which to make the first great discoveries in 20th century astronomy. One noticeable peak in the Diablo Range, some 40 miles from the sea, was known to early settlers as La Sierra de Isabel. The first to record an ascent to its uppermost reaches were William Brewer, a geologist who worked on California's first complete geological survey, and Charles Hoffman, a topographer. Laurentine Hamilton, then a Presbyterian minister from San Jose, tagged along for the 1861 summertime adventure. While journeying over the lower elevations, the men used mules, but struggled over the last 3 miles on foot. With the two scientists burdened down by their heavy equipment, the minister was able to sprint ahead, pushing through the chaparral, mesquite, and thick groves of scrub oak that filled the mountain's furrowed sides like well-sprinkled seasoning. Upon reaching the summit, Hamilton waved his hat in the air and exclaimed, "First on top, for this is the highest point." In honor of the achievement, Brewer graciously named the peak after his noble and true friend. Within 3 decades, Mount Hamilton was the site of a radical new endeavor in astronomy. Fueled by America's escalating wealth, the public mind in this country is now directed to the importance of original scientific research, wrote Joseph Henry, head of the Smithsonian Institution in 1874, to the noted English biologist Thomas Huxley. And I think there is good reason to believe that some of the millionaires who have risen from poverty to wealth will in due time seek to perpetuate their names by founding establishments for the purpose in question. In the vanguard to answer that call was San Francisco entrepreneur James Lick, who funded the world's first astronomical observatory permanently established at high elevation. Before this, professional telescopes were routinely constructed in relatively low-lying areas, near major cities, or on university campuses for easy access. In 1888, from its commanding perch atop Mount Hamilton, the Lick Observatory began operating the largest telescope in its day, which featured a pair of imposing lenses a full yard wide to gather and magnify the celestial light. It was the same type of telescope through which Galileo first peered, one that directed the light through two aligned pieces of glass, but the diameter of the Lick instrument was a couple of dozen times larger. Its founder spared no expense to house this giant refractor. The massive building was designed in a classical style by Washington architect S.E. Todd. From afar, it appeared as if a European palace had been magically transported to the American West. Inside its dome, hand-carved moldings decorated the walls. The floors were curved wooden planks, polished to a sheen, and stylishly following the shape of the circular dome. Tourists traveled on stagecoach for hours for a glimpse of this new wonder of the scientific world. Unbeknownst to those visitors, though, the most innovative work at Lick was actually being done in more modest surroundings, about a quarter of a mile south of the show-stopping telescope, at the end of a mountain spur known as Ptolemy Ridge. There, in a far smaller dome that resembles a quaint medieval chapel, James Keeler labored to put a reflecting telescope into operation, which used a silvered mirror instead of a lens to magnify its image. It was an instrument that everyone warned him would be nothing but trouble. Big-lensed refractors were the telescopes of choice in the late 1800s, but Keeler bravely broke from that tradition, establishing an approach in professional astronomy that eventually spread to every major observatory throughout the world. Though now reduced to a minor figure in many histories of astronomy, Keeler was actually a forerunner to the birth of modern cosmology, a crucial player in helping launch the new field. A man who could manipulate a spectroscope like no other, he pioneered uses for the new instrument at a time when astronomers were just beginning to apply the methods of physics in their work. This specialty, newly tagged astrophysics, enabled observers at last to discern the chemical and physical natures of stars, planets, and nebulae. In Keeler's time, the universe was a far simpler place, at least to our modern-day eyes. The cosmos consisted solely of a vast collection of stars, a disc-shaped distribution somewhat flattened, with the sun situated in an honored place near the center. Beyond that, said most astronomers, was simply a void, possibly extending out to infinity. But there were oddities in the celestial sky, difficult to explain. There were these mysterious nebulae that through a telescope looked like watery whirlpools, mist-like clouds exhibiting spiraling shapes. Astronomers were long acquainted with other types of nebulae, such as the vast and chaotic cloud in Orion and the ring-like nebulae, but these vaporous objects resided within the bounds of the Milky Way. The spiral nebulae, on the other hand, were solely found away from the Milky Band of our galaxy. Why did they prefer the more open cosmic spaces, as if they were avoiding the stars? Astronomers didn't have a good, rational explanation for this unique distribution. Keeler, to his credit, made these nebulae his prime subject for investigation, at a time when the study of stars and planets was far more attractive to astronomers. Before the introduction of photography, the number of nebulous clouds in the heavens was estimated to be in the thousands. Mounting a camera onto his reflecting telescope, Keeler began to realize there were likely tens of thousands. His discovery was a revelation, and in making this masterful leap in observing, Keeler opened up a vast new arena for astronomy. Keeler's celestial curiosity may have initially been sparked by a dramatic solar eclipse he witnessed in 1869 when he was 11. Its narrow path of totality creating a sensation as the moon's shadow stretched across the United States. A few months later, his family moved from Illinois to Mayport, Florida, where Keeler was homeschooled, surrounded by the stacks of Scientific Americans to which his father subscribed. Ordering some lenses from an optical dealer who advertised in the magazine, young Keeler built his first telescope, a 2.5-inch refractor with a cedar tube. He was soon spending long nights at his scope, drawing sketches of lunar craters and the planets. He was riding the wave of a new American fancy. Earlier in the 19th century, astronomical research in the United States had been a rather haphazard affair, until two key events dramatically altered the situation. In the autumn of 1833, people throughout the country witnessed a meteor storm, torrents of shooting stars like no other. It was described as a constant succession of fireballs, resembling skyrockets, radiating in all directions from a point in the heavens, which led to the spectacular celestial fireworks show being called the Falling of the Stars. A decade later, the public went agog once again over the Great Comet of 1843. Proclaimed by Yale astronomer Dennison Olmsted in that pre-electric era as the most remarkable in its appearance of all that have been seen in modern times. The comet was visible even in daylight, with a nucleus as bright as the full moon, and a tail that stretched for nearly 2 million miles. Together, the meteor blizzard and the comet sparked a huge surge of public interest in the heavens. It also made U.S. politicians woefully aware of their country's lack of first-rate scientific institutions to study such captivating phenomena. The English novelist Francis Trollope, who spent some time in America in the 1820s, had found it extraordinary that a people who loudly declare their respect for science should be entirely without observatories. Neither at their seats of learning nor in their cities does anything of the kind exist. This deficiency was quickly remedied with the opening of observatories in both Cincinnati, Ohio, and Chapel Hill, North Carolina, and at colleges such as Yale, Harvard, and Williams. The U.S. Naval Observatory, the country's first national observatory, also obtained its first decent telescope. During this period before the Civil War, additional observatories quickly sprang up, becoming the scientific facility de rigueur for major American cities and colleges. These efforts at last fulfilled the vision of John Quincy Adams, America's sixth president, who had long pushed for the country to erect a lighthouse in the sky. Some Americans, haunted by a nagging sense of cultural inferiority and smarting from invidious comparisons with Europe, fostered astronomical research as a matter of national pride, writes historian Howard Miller. And once in place, these pioneering astronomical outposts stimulated a continuing interest, especially among young boys like Keeler, who dreamed of one day taking part in this new American endeavor. Described by acquaintances as a lanky green country boy with a backwoods cracker drawl, Keeler came to develop special skills in building instruments, which enabled him to enter Johns Hopkins, America's first research university, just a year after the institution opened in Baltimore, Maryland. Upon graduation in 1881, Keeler began work near Pittsburgh at the Allegheny Observatory, headed up by Samuel P. Langley, the man who, two decades later, would almost beat the Wright brothers in getting a piloted, self-propelled aircraft flying. A year of graduate work in Germany in 1883 to 84 sharpened Keeler's expertise in spectral analysis. All this preparation turned out to be indispensable when he received an offer to join the staff of the Lick Observatory, the revolutionary new mecca for astronomy in Central California. James Lick initiated a remarkable trend. He stood at the head of a long line of prosperous benefactors in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, who used the business fortunes they accrued in the United States to construct some of the most productive observatories in astronomical history. Given his largesse, Lick raised the stakes in astronomy. Before this, the most acclaimed observatories were in Europe and sponsored by either universities or governments. With resources sparse, these institutions were often slow to adopt new techniques and instruments. At each observatory, surveys plugged along for decades, often using just one key telescope. But the Lick Observatory offered a new model for research, one that ran at a quicker pace, enriched by private capital. Lick made big telescopes the commemorative monument of choice among the American nouveau riche. Moreover, with these privately funded observatories being established from scratch, they were able to purchase the finest instruments and adopt the latest technologies. As a consequence, astronomy advanced in the United States at a faster pace than in any other country in the history of science. Starting from essentially zero at the beginning of the 19th century, says historian Stephen Brush, the Americans had overtaken the Germans to jump into second place by the end of that century, and were already challenging the British for the top spot. Domination of the heavens appeared to go hand in hand with economic riches. Lick earned his riches. Born in 1796 to a rural Pennsylvania Dutch family, just as the new Republic of the United States was getting underway, he learned the trade of woodworking at the side of his father. After making a fairly comfortable living running his own shop in New York City, Lick abruptly decided in 1821 to move to South America, bent on amassing a fortune. There, he became a master builder of fine wood piano cases, a venture that proved highly lucrative in a culture where dancing and music were greatly valued. After 27 years, though, living at first in Argentina, then Chile, and finally Peru, he decided to sell his varied business concerns and return to the United States. Arriving in San Francisco by ship in 1848, just as California was about to secede from Mexico, he came ashore with $30,000 in gold doubloons and 600 pounds of Peruvian chocolate made by his friend, Domingo Ghirardelli. Wasting no time, Lick quickly put his incisive business acumen to work. He shrewdly used his gold to purchase real estate in San Francisco, then just a scrubby town with scarcely 1,000 inhabitants. When residents started heading to the hills to make their fortune in the California gold rush, Lick was there to provide them with a stake by buying up their town land at bargain prices. He also bought a grist mill, greatly expanding it, and built California's first great luxury hotel, the opulent Lick House, which occupied an entire city block, and was later destroyed in the fire that tore through San Francisco after a terrific 1906 earthquake. Lick never married, but still built a homestead at the south end of San Jose, where he lovingly cultivated rare plants and shrubs from around the world. The community considered him an eccentric miser. He dressed like a tramp, and at times slept on a bare mattress laid out atop a piano crate. As a youth, he had gotten a girl pregnant, but her father, a prosperous miller, refused his offer to marry her, judging Lick too poor and socially inferior. The miller could hardly have imagined how astronomy, decades later, would benefit from this snobbish rebuff. Without a legitimate heir, Lick, in his old age, began to think of using some of his tremendous wealth. He had accumulated nearly $4 million, around $100 million in today's dollars, to erect a gargantuan monument to himself. For Lick, it was a chance at immortality. He particularly favored the idea of constructing a giant marble pyramid on the corner of 4th and Market Streets in downtown San Francisco, a structure that would have surpassed Egypt's Great Pyramid of Giza in size. But a few auspicious encounters revised this vainglorious plan. Lick had once spent a few days with a visiting amateur astronomer and lecturer, George Madeira, who captivated him with talks about astronomy's latest discoveries. They met again a few years later for some telescope viewing, when Madeira allegedly asserted, "If I had your wealth, Mr. Lick, I would construct the largest telescope possible to construct." Around the same time, Joseph Henry, then head of the National Academy of Sciences, as well as the Smithsonian, was visiting San Francisco and arranged a meeting with Lick to discuss how wealthy men could use their money to cultivate science. The following year, 1872, the Harvard naturalist Louis Agassiz gave a widely reported lecture at the California Academy of Sciences, where Agassiz echoed Henry's refrain. All these lessons struck a chord. Lick soon astonished the California Academy when he granted the Institute, without prior notice, the gift of a downtown lot to build a museum and more expansive headquarters. Academy President George Davidson, a geodetic surveyor and astronomer, promptly called on Lick to thank him, initiating a friendship. When Lick was later felled by a stroke and confined to a two-room suite at his hotel for nearly a year, Davidson regularly visited, engaging Lick with chats about the rings of Saturn, the belts of Jupiter, and other astronomical topics. Lick soon abandoned his scheme to build a pyramid and decided instead to erect a telescope superior to and more powerful than any telescope yet made, right on his favorite city spot, the corner of 4th and Market. An in-town telescope was never built, fortunately, largely due to Davidson's intervention. As both an amateur astronomer and a geodesist, a profession that took him to towering mountain sites, he had long been convinced that astronomy would best be served by taking its instruments to the highest elevations possible, where a telescope's resolution would improve immensely in the clearer, more rarefied atmosphere. Isaac Newton first pointed this out in the 18th century. "For the air through which we look upon the stars is in a perpetual tremor," he wrote in his optics. The only remedy is a most serene and quiet air, such as may perhaps be found on the tops of the highest mountains, above the grosser clouds, and preferably in a region with a dry season, free of rain. Over time, Lick came to accept Davidson's compelling idea, and in the fall of 1873, authorized the funds to construct a state-of-the-art observatory in the arid Sierra Nevada mountain range at an elevation of 10,000 feet. Caught up in the excitement of this novel venture, Lick pledged $1 million, a princely sum. No observatory had ever been established in such a remote and elevated locale. In that decisive shift, astronomy would soon change in a remarkable way, whisking the field away from its previous urban settings. Over the next 3 years, Lick fiddled with the provisions of his trust, fired and hired assorted board trustees, reduced the price tag to a tight-fisted $700,000, and changed his mind on the telescope's location. Once set for a spot near Lake Tahoe by the Nevada border, the site was eventually shifted to Mount Hamilton, a shorter peak, 4,200 feet high, just to the east of San Jose, where Lick could look up and proudly view it from his property. Davidson, sorely disappointed by the lowered elevation and Lick's parsimonious ways, left the project and refused to speak to his former benefactor ever again. Davidson's snub mattered little in the end, for Lick soon passed away. He died on October 1, 1876, at the age of 80. Only then did construction of the mountaintop observatory, an arduous and unprecedented endeavor, truly get underway. Congress at last approved transfer of the public land. The local county built a road to the top, and the mountain peak was certified by an expert as exceptional for its atmospheric stability. Mount Hamilton's sharp, knife-edged profile causes minimal disturbance as air flows in from the west. Fulfilling Lick's decree, the largest refracting telescope in the world, one with lenses 10 inches wider than the previous record holder at the U.S. Naval Observatory, was installed in a magnificent domed building designed in the Italian Renaissance style and large enough to accommodate the scope's lengthy tube. Massive hydraulic cylinders allowed an astronomer to raise or lower the entire circular floor to keep him level with the telescopic eyepiece. The top 30 feet of the mountain had been blasted away to provide a level space for the rambling complex, which included housing, workshops, offices, and a library. The observatory operated as a small town, with families living on site, and supplies brought up daily by wagon from San Jose. A visitor dubbed it the Little Republic of Science. Lick became the new republic's patron saint, for his egotism never completely disappeared with his noble gift to astronomy, even after his death. In January 1887, as soon as the telescope base was complete, Lick's remains were brought up the mountain and reburied, his body resting directly under the grand instrument he funded, in the very base of the pier supporting the giant refractor. Tour groups still visit the tomb today. Davidson claimed credit, as did others, for the interment idea, first voiced when Lick was alive. He was surprised the old man agreed. At the time, Davidson had suggested a cremation and burial of the ashes, to which the former carpenter quickly replied, "No, sir, I intend to rot like a gentleman." The choice for director of the new Lick Observatory was Edward Holden, a graduate of West Point and an unaccomplished astronomer, whose sole qualification seemed to be that his energy and initiative had once impressed Simon Newcomb, then America's most revered astronomer, while he was assisting Newcomb at the Naval Observatory. A proud and pompous man, Holden at least had a keen eye for talent. Aware of Keeler's outstanding work at Allegheny, Holden hired him in 1886 to get the new mountaintop observatory and its equipment up and running. Of all Holden's hires, James Keeler was by far the best trained. Bringing Keeler to the mountain was the best decision Holden ever made during his tumultuous directorship. 2. A rather remarkable number of nebulae. Keeler traveled to the Lick Observatory along a road that was a marvel of engineering in its day. Although Mount Hamilton is less than a mile high, the journey from its base to the top is more than 20 miles in length, with the roadway sinuously zigging and zagging as it gradually ascends. There are some 360 switchbacks in all, and some were even given special names, such as the Tunnel, Crocodile Jaw, and Oh My Point, branded by the oft-heard refrain as people sat atop the stagecoach and looked down in horror at the point's steep drop-off. The serpentine route was installed to maintain a gentle gradient, so that stagecoach horses in the 19th century never needed to break their stride. Upon reaching the top, Keeler was immediately enamored of the breathtaking scenery. The view from the observatory peak is a very beautiful one, particularly in the spring, when the surrounding hills are covered with bright green verdure, and the eye looks down upon acres of wildflowers. He later wrote in a pamphlet for visitors, "To the west lies the lovely Santa Clara Valley, shut in from the ocean by mountains somewhat lower than the Mount Hamilton range. Sometimes the entire valley is filled with clouds, rolling onward under a clear sky and bright sun like a river of snow. The surrounding mountaintops project out of the fog like black islands. Often the ocean fog arrives at sunset, rolling in from the Pacific at the Golden Gate to the north and Monterey Bay to the south." Not everyone on the mountain was enthusiastic about Keeler's arrival. The observatory's superintendent, Thomas Fraser, was initially wary of the newcomer. "If he has the right ring, all will be right," said Fraser. "But if stubborn, then things will go wrong, and he will have to leave. That is all there is to it." It didn't take long, though, for Fraser to be won over by the exceptional skill Keeler displayed as the telescope was being prepared for operation. Its great lenses were finally installed on New Year's Eve, 1887, but due to severe weather, the staff could not test the telescope out until a few days later. Often in the wintertime, storms would sweep over the mountain, with winds gusting more than 60 miles per hour, which would drift the snow about the dwellings more than 10 feet high. Once the staff got back to the telescope, the trial run did not go well. To their horror, the astronomers discovered that Alvin Clark, the telescope maker, had misstated the instrument's required length. Much like the Hubble Space Telescope's initial mishap a century later, they couldn't get it into focus. The telescope's tube should have extended 56 feet, but instead was 6 inches too long, forcing them to get out their tools and spend valuable days cutting the tube down to size. Clark's son, a partner in the telescope firm, was there for the trial. "A terrible old blow and grumbler," Keeler told Holden. While Clark insisted that his firm's glass was superb and the eyepieces triumphs of art, he declared the dome worthless. With its tube shortened, the telescope was at last tried out on January 7, 1888, a cloudless night that was piercingly cold. With the dome frozen solid that evening, the handful of staff members and guests present could only passively observe the objects that happened to pass by the dome slit, open toward the southeast. Yet, no inconvenience was felt, beyond the necessity of a little waiting, recalled Keeler. He was pleased to find the clock running smoothly, and the mounting working well. The group first observed Rigel, a blue-white double star, followed by the Orion Nebula, its great streamers making it one of the most spellbinding sights through a telescope. "Here the great light-gathering power of the object glass was strikingly apparent," Keeler noted. Then, just after midnight, Saturn came into view. Keeler reported that the planet was, "beyond doubt, the greatest telescopic spectacle ever beheld by man. The giant planet, with its wonderful rings, its belts, its satellites, shone with a splendor and distinctness of detail never before equaled." Everyone in the party took a look. Afterward, Keeler spent some time studying Saturn more carefully, which led to Lick Observatory's first discovery. He spied a fine, dark line in Saturn's outer ring, a mere spider's thread, as he described it. It was a breach, now best known for historic reasons as the Encke Gap, after an early 19th century German astronomer, that had never before been clearly seen. A superb drawing Keeler made of Saturn, based on his sketch of the planet that night, was displayed at the 1893 Chicago World's Fair. 6 feet tall, with fair, wavy hair, Keeler cut a fine figure. Despite his isolated upbringing in rural Florida, he became a keen judge of human nature, and was often called upon to handle personnel and scientific crises at the observatory, which he carried out with the calm discretion of an international diplomat. He was tolerant, amused, and unwilling to take sides, said Keeler's biographer Donald Osterbrock. He always sought to put the best construction he could on anyone's activities, to emphasize the positive, and never to criticize unless absolutely necessary. It was perhaps not the most courageous philosophy in the world, but it took him far. And as an astronomer, Keeler was outstanding, studying a range of subjects from solar eclipses to planetary features. Photography was still in its infancy, so Keeler continued to make drawings that were praised by his colleagues as marvelous reproductions. Beautiful and accurate, reported fellow Lick astronomer Edward E. Barnard in a notice to the Royal Astronomical Society. Keeler has a real artistic ability, such as very few observers possess. Keeler's real forte, however, was in using a spectroscope, which was a relatively recent addition to astronomy's instrumental arsenal. The scientific basis for it was established in the 17th century. A young Isaac Newton, sitting in a darkened room in 1666, let a small stream of sunlight enter through a hole in his window shutter. He then passed it through a triangular prism of glass. Beholding a rainbow of colors on the wall behind him, an enchanting phenomenon observed with pieces of glass since antiquity, Newton clearly demonstrated that white light was a mixture of many hues. On one end was a band of red, followed by orange, yellow, green, and blue, until it reached a deep violet on the other end. He dubbed this multicolored display a spectrum, a word previously used to denote an apparition or phantom. By the early 19th century, Joseph von Fraunhofer, a master Bavarian optician, cleverly combined a slit, a prism, and a small telescope, what came to be called a spectroscope, to examine the spectrum of the sun more closely. Peering through the eyepiece, he was surprised to discern hundreds of dark lines in the spectrum, as if a series of black threads had been sewn across a rainbow. They resembled the ubiquitous barcodes now found on consumer products. But unfortunately, Fraunhofer died before he could pursue the origin of those mysterious dark slashes. Answers arrived from the creative experiments being conducted in chemistry laboratories. Even before Fraunhofer's spectral tests, chemists had noticed that metals or salts, when heated to incandescence, emit certain colors. Salts containing sodium, for example, burn an intense yellow-orange when heated by a hot flame. When looking at the heated material through a spectroscope, the chemists saw that its spectrum was composed of discrete lines of color, resembling a picket fence with colorful posts. Whereas the solar spectrum was a continuous rainbow riddled with dark lines, these laboratory spectra were the exact opposite, thin, bright lines of colorful emissions set against a dark background. By 1859, the physicist Gustav Kirchhoff and the chemist Robert Bunsen, creator of the legendary lab burner, at last revealed the meaning behind these bright and dark lines. With the clear, hot flame of Bunsen's improved instrument, free of the deceptive contamination that plagued earlier researchers, the two German colleagues were able to conclusively prove that each chemical element produces a characteristic pattern of colored lines when heated and viewed through a spectroscope. The elements weren't emitting an entire rainbow, but rather just a few select colors. More consequential, the patterns were as unique and distinguishing as a fingerprint. Each element on the periodic table had its own personal set of emissions. Using their spectroscope one evening to peer at a distant fire in the port city of Mannheim, visible across the Rhine plain from their laboratory window, Kirchhoff and Bunsen were thrilled to detect the spectral signatures of barium and strontium in the roaring blaze. It didn't take long for them to fathom that they could analyze the sun and stars in a similar fashion, as light knows no distance in the voids of space. Light can be sent through a spectroscope, whether it originates from a distance of 1 foot, 10 miles, or a billion light years away. Before this revelation, astronomers only knew that a star shines, that it occupies a certain position on the celestial sphere, and in some cases moves. But now they were acquiring the means to determine a star's composition and temperature, information once thought impossible to glean. When an element is hot and glowing, it radiates its distinctive pattern of spectral colors. But at other times, it can absorb those same wavelengths, which explains the origin of the dark lines that Fraunhofer found in the solar spectrum. Each element in the sun's cooler outer atmosphere absorbs its designated colors, robbing the sunshine of those selected wavelengths before they arrive on Earth. The bright lines are simply the reverse of this process, the elements emitting those very same wavelengths of light as they fiercely burn. Either way, dark or bright, the pattern of lines indicates the presence of the element. Not until the early 20th century, with the advent of atomic physics, did scientists come to understand this behavior as arising from the electrons in an atom jumping from one energy level to another, the atoms emitting bursts of light when they lose energy, and gaining energy when they absorb the photons. Astronomers quickly realized that, along with revealing a star's composition, a stellar spectrum could also tell them how the star was moving. In the 1840s, the Austrian physicist Christian Doppler had surmised that the frequency of a wave, such as the tone of a sound wave or the color of a light wave, would be altered whenever the source of the wave moved. We've all heard the pitch of a siren rise to a higher tone as a police car or ambulance races toward us. This is the very effect that Doppler spoke of. The sound waves emitted by the screeching siren crowd together as they approach us, shortening their length and likewise raising the pitch. Conversely, as the police car pulls away, the sound waves stretch out, producing a lower pitch. In an analogous fashion, a light wave's length is shortened, gets bluer, when the source of the light approaches, and is lengthened, gets redder, when the source moves away. Astronomers, though, don't assess the overall color of a star or galaxy to measure its speed. That would be too difficult. They can more easily examine how the bright and dark lines in a celestial spectrum shift from their well-known laboratory positions. Depending on the object's motion, the lines can shift toward either the blue or red end of the spectrum. If a star or nebula, for example, is headed for us, its spectral lines move over toward the blue. That is, the lines get blue-shifted. If moving away, the lines swing over toward the red, and hence become red-shifted. The exact velocity is pegged from the amount of shift in the spectral bands. Blue shifts and red shifts are nothing less than the speedometers of the universe. Keeler had the eye of a hawk in measuring how the celestial light entering his spectroscope was separated into its component wavelengths, with each spectral line offering enticing clues. He was America's leading practitioner of this new technique, with some of his best work being done on measuring the speeds of nebulae within the Milky Way. In Latin, nebulae is the word for clouds, or mist, exactly what these extended objects look like through a telescope. Some are roundish, and were dubbed planetary nebulae in the 18th century by British astronomer William Herschel, who thought they resembled planets through his telescope. Today, astronomers know that such circular nebulae are the result of aging stars casting off their outer envelopes. Other nebulae, such as the renowned Orion Nebula, are more irregular and diffuse, made luminous by the new stars being born within these great cosmic oceans of gas. By the late 1880s, as Keeler entered his 30s and continued these celestial explorations, he faced a career crisis. He was eager to marry Cora Matthews, the niece of Richard Floyd, the supervisor of the observatory's construction and president of the Lick Trust. The couple had first met on the mountain, but could not tie the knot right away, because Lick officials would not provide them adequate housing at the observatory once married. There was also Keeler's growing dissatisfaction with Director Holden, a tyrannical and humorless man who often tried to share credit for some of Keeler's discoveries, and at times ordered the young man to carry out observations he was not eager to do. It was said that Holden, given his West Point background, ran the observatory as though it were a fort in hostile territory, barking out commands like a general under siege. On top of that, there was the tiresome isolation atop the mountain, with few opportunities to escape to the city and engage in a fuller social life. "I am a human being first, and an astronomer afterwards," Keeler confessed to a friend. Faced with these growing concerns, Keeler began networking among his astronomer contacts, and in 1891 secured the directorship of the Allegheny Observatory, a return to his first place of employment. His old boss Langley had by then moved to Washington, D.C., where he served as secretary of the Smithsonian Institution, and was beginning work on his lifelong dream to successfully launch a flying machine. In terms of telescope power, Keeler's transfer to the Allegheny Observatory, situated on a hill across the river just north of America's steel capital, was a giant leap backward. The weather was poorer. The air was tainted with Pittsburgh's industrial smoke. The atmosphere was more turbulent for viewing. And the observatory's main telescope was a 13-inch refractor, far smaller than Lick's 36-incher. Yet in some ways, it was a blessing. The constraints forced him to focus his astrophysical studies on such objects as nebulae, a less trendy territory, and hence riper for discovery. Because of their larger size, compared to stars, the fuzzy objects could still be adequately examined, even with a smaller scope. Moreover, astronomical photography had become more efficient and convenient, allowing him to build up exposures and see spectral details he could not see before with his eye alone. He doggedly tracked down every new advance in spectroscopic and photographic equipment, in hope of offsetting Lick Observatory's advantages. The experience, though exhausting, only enhanced his astronomical abilities. From his new post in Pennsylvania, Keeler eventually made headlines worldwide. He had been using his spectroscope at Allegheny to measure how fast some of the major planets, such as Venus, Jupiter, and Saturn, were rotating. Based on a method already used to gauge the sun's rotation, Keeler knew that a spectral line in light arriving from the edge of the planet rotating toward us would be shifted toward the blue end of the spectrum. This same line would shift equally the other way, toward the red, when emanating from the edge or limb of the planet moving away.
Along the way. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.